Well, come on, if you love Jesus this morning, why don't you give him some praise today? Oh, come on, City First Church, you could do better than that. Come on, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let's rejoice and be glad in it. Are there any glad people in the house? Hallelujah. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Don't get comfortable. You might be back up again. Come on, somebody. How many of you are glad and excited that you came to the house of God this morning? Come on. I'm telling you, I already have ridiculous expectation for what God is going to do in this place. I am not just excited to be here. I am Red Bull excited and espresso elated. I have been waiting with tiptoe anticipation just to get my chocolate face in the place. We're going to have a good time in here today. If this weekend was any indication of what God is going to do, I know it's going to be great. Where are all the men at in the house? Can you make some noise one last time? I'm telling you, we had such an amazing time this weekend. If you were not here as a man, you missed out. You better get ready for next year because it was just awesome. In fact, I still got a holy hangover from all that God did. He just met us in such an incredible way, and it's going to be good this morning. If you're wondering why I'm still here preaching this morning, it's actually kind of a funny story. Pastor Jeremy called me up. It's a very quick conversation, very quick. And he said, "Robert, do you believe in free speech?" I said, "Pastor Jeremy, absolutely I do." He said, "Good, give two on Sunday at City First Church." So that's why I'm here. No, that's not what happened. But man, it's my earnest prayer that you would just know how blessed you are to be a part of this church. This is not an ordinary church. This is an extraordinary church. God's hand is upon you. His favor is upon you. And man, great churches don't happen by accident. They happen because of great leadership. And you guys are blessed with two incredible leaders who I think are just two of the greatest people on the planet. Come on, can we thank God for Pastor Jeremy and Jim for who they are? Come on, y'all could do better than that, man. Y'all are blessed. Come on, to have two pastors that love you, that have vision, that care about you. Come on. Thank God for you, man. I honor you. And I'm just glad he would let me stand behind this pulpit. We're going to have a good time. I do bring you greetings, as it was said, from the great country of Texas. I have lived there my entire life in Dallas. I'm married to the finest woman on the planet. Her name is Taylor. We have been married now for, 4 years, 6 months, 8 days, 3 minutes, and 22 seconds. And she's not here with me. She is at home with our two kids, have a 2-year-old daughter and a 1-year-old son. So we are rookie parents, to say the least. And you know how some rookie parents are. As soon as they become parents, they think their kid's the most beautiful kid in the world, and always putting up pictures of their kid because they think everybody wants to see their kid. I'm not that dad. I made a vow to not be that dad. So you don't have to worry about me putting my kids on the screen this morning. This is about me preaching Jesus, not you seeing my children. So we're good. That's not even true. If you don't put my baby girl on every screen up in this church, come on, City First. Woo! Hey, I made that. That is my baby girl. Her name is Everly Adair Madu. We call her Evie. She is the reason that I pray more and I have a gun permit. And for real. And then we were just blessed with a baby boy. He just turned one. Put my son up there. That is my legacy, my namesake. 2 for 2 now. That's my baby boy, Robert Madu III. And man, I put their pictures up everywhere I go because fatherhood is the best hood. There is nothing like being a dad, and I love it. Amen? And we're going to have fun. Did anybody come to get a word today? I'm telling you, if y'all feel like hearing this, like I feel like preaching it, it's going to be good up in here. If you have a Bible, I want to turn your attention to Hebrews chapter number 12. We'll look at verses 1 and 2, then also 1 Samuel 18, 5 through 9. Hebrews 12, 1 and 2, and 1 Samuel 18, 5 through 9. If you have a Bible with you, why don't you wave it in the air like you just do care? Awesome. Some of your Bibles are glowing. You charged up your Bible last night. Proud of you. This is my first time here on a Sunday, so quick disclaimer. There are so many different preaching styles in the body of Christ. There are some preachers who are very calm, very quiet, very stoic and sedate as they stand behind a pulpit or a sacred desk to softly pontificate the processes of philosophy, eschatology, and soteriology. And they would consider it uncanny and boisterous for you to say anything while they're sharing what the Lord has deposited in the deep recesses of their heart, soul, mind, and spirit. I ain't one of those preachers, okay? I am what you call a holla back preacher, okay? All that means is I preach better and shorter. Come on, somebody. I'm trying to get you to lunch. If you get verbally involved, okay, if anything I say resonates with you, you can say amen. You can say preach that. You can say, that was good. You can literally stand up in the middle and go, whoo, that was for me. You can also stand up in the middle and go, ooh, that was for you. For real, I know you need any one of those will work. Hebrews chapter 12, starting at verse 1, it says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up, and let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. What an awesome thought to consider, that God has set a race before each and every one of us, and we are required to run that race. How do we do it? The writer of Hebrews tells us, we do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Can you say amen? And then 1 Samuel 18, verses 5 through 9, we're going to be reading from Eugene Peterson's Message translation. And it says, whatever Saul gave David to do, he did it and did it well. So well that Saul put him in charge of his military operations. Everybody, both the people in general and Saul's servants, approved of and admired David's leadership. As they returned home, after David had killed the Philistine, the women poured out of all of the villages of Israel, singing and dancing, welcoming King Saul with tambourines, festive songs, and lutes. I'm not really sure what a lute is, but I'm assuming it's like a flute without the F. And profound, I know. It says, in playful frolic, that made me laugh, playful frolic. You know it's a party when people are taking the time to frolic, okay? In playful frolic, the women sang, Saul kills by the thousand, David by the 10,000. Ooh, this made Saul angry, very angry. He took it as a personal insult. He said, huh, they credit David with 10,000s, but me with only thousands? Before you know it, they'll be giving him the kingdom. From that moment on, Saul kept his eye on David. Ooh, I don't want to preach before I preach, so don't count this as my preaching time. But I would like you just for a moment to see these two passages of scripture in parallel. Because here we have the writer of Hebrews who says, hey, there's a race that's been set before you, and you run the race by keeping your eyes on who? On Jesus. But here we have Saul, because of a comparison that these ladies made between him and David, no longer is he focused on his race, but comparison is so strong, it caused Saul to focus all of his attention, all of his energy onto David. Today, if you're taking notes, I hope you are, I wanna preach from this thought, on their mark. That's my title for today, on their mark. I realize when you're running a race, they say, get on your mark. But I'm finding many people in the body of Christ cannot run the race God has set before them simply because they have their eyes on the people in the lanes beside them. So instead of being on your mark, you're on, ooh, I'm already preaching. This is going to be good in here today. Come on, can we pray before we go into this word and ask God to speak to us? It's going to be a long prayer, but just bear with me. Would you bow your heads? God, you are awesome. Speak to us today. Amen. quick little sermonic survey before we really delve into this. How many of you would say, just by a showing of hands, that you like to work out, you enjoy exercise? Can I see your hand today? Like to work out. Oh, wow. It's even more hands in the first service. Come on, the healthy people are in second service. Awesome. You can put it down. How many of you would say, by a showing of hands, that you do not like to work out, you don't enjoy exercise? Let me see your hand. Come on, don't lie in church. Okay. Awesome. You can put it down. Those of you who lifted up your hand the first time, saying that you like to work out, that you actually enjoy exercise, you are officially dismissed from this service, okay? No, for real. You can leave. As a matter of fact, run home, okay? because I have now found some camaraderie and some commonality with the second group of people. Y'all are my people, okay? I will lift up both hands, both feet, tell the truth, and shame the devil, okay? I do not like to work out. There is absolutely nothing in me that finds enjoyment or pleasure in going to the gym. As a matter of fact, I am theologically and physiologically persuaded that having to work out was as a result of the fall of man. Oh, I'm serious, people. There were no gyms in Genesis, okay? There were no ellipticals in the Garden of Eden, all right? You can't have Pilates and have paradise. God, in his infinite wisdom and his omnipotent power, created us as perfectly perfect beings. Perfectly perfect. That means Adam had biceps. He had triceps. He didn't have a one-pack. He had a six-pack. Ladies, Eve had 0% body fat. 0%. Some of you are like, Robert, what's your scripture for that? I'll give you some scripture. I'll give you scripture. The Bible says that they were both naked and unashamed. Come on, somebody. You only walk around naked if you got it going on. I'm just saying. It was not until they took of the forbidden fruit that sin and calories entered into the world. So I don't like to work out, but I do work out. I do work out. And the reason I do what I hate is because of what I love, which is to eat, okay? I love to eat. I'm a much better eater than I am a faster, okay? Don't hate on me. That's my spiritual gift. And whenever I go to the gym, I actually enjoy lifting weights. I love to lift. There's something manly about putting on Old Spice and lifting iron, okay? I like to lift weights. But how many know lifting does not burn the calories? Don't burn the calories. You got to do cardio, which means you have to engage in an evil three-letter word called run. Whew, city first, this is my issue, okay? I hate to run. I despise running, okay? I cannot articulate to you how much I hate to run. I hate that run rhymes with fun because there's nothing fun to me about running, okay? Whenever I do run, I convince my mind I have asthma just so I can stop running, okay? So for me to get on a treadmill is a big deal and I need a lot of motivation. I gotta have a Nike Just Do It t-shirt, motivational music. I got the eye of a tiger. I need all that just to get on the treadmill. And once I get on the treadmill, I will start at a good glacial pace and I'll be going. I'm like, oh, this is easy. This is awesome. I've been running for like, feels like 30 minutes. Then I look at the screen, it's like 3 minutes. I'm like, my asthma, I can't do this. I'm about to die today. So I developed this move, and I'm letting out my secrets. I've developed this move as a mechanism for motivation to keep running on the treadmill. True story, as I'm running on the treadmill, wanting to quit and throw in the towel, I would just slowly look to the right, and then I would look to the left, and I would just peruse the aisle of other people who are running on their treadmills. And what I'm doing is, I'm looking for somebody, anybody, a bunch older than me body. And once I found that random person, I will lock my eye in on that person, and I will say something to them. Not out loud, but in my mind, real loud. I will say to them, psh, you don't want none. Now, let me explain what just happened when I said, psh, you don't want none. When I said that, unbeknownst to that person, we just entered into a race. Oh, y'all gonna act like I'm the only one that does this. Okay. Like, when I said that, this workout just got real, okay? As soon as I made that declaration, the entire gymnasium has now been transformed to the 2017 Olympics, and the first person to get off the treadmill is going home with the silver, and the one that stays on the longest is going home with the gold, and I'm gonna get the gold because I'm a child of God, the head and not the tail. All we do is win, 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 no matter what. Come on, can I get a witness up in here in the second service? True story. And it really helps me when the person is right next to me, because then I can see their screen and see exactly how fast they're going. You know what I'm saying? So it's even. So if they're on level 6, I'm on level 6.1. And if they speed up, I'm going to speed up. If they go on an incline, I'm going to go on an incline. If they stop and take a break, I'm going to stop and take a break. Oh, yes, I'm not going to keep running while they stop and take a break. That's cheating. You can't cheat in the Olympics. This is a global event. So whatever they do, I will do. And then I'll wait for it. And as soon as they press stop and get off, I will speed mine up to the fastest level, because you got to sprint to the finish line. Then I'll press stop, jump off, grab my towel, say, I got the gold, and rejoice in my sweet victory. Well, I wish I was lying, but I'm being so real with y'all today. As a matter of fact, I beat a guy a couple of weeks ago, random guy, and I beat him bad too. And I saw him in the locker room afterwards, and I said, hey man, how are you? He said, I'm good, how are you? I said, I'm great. In fact, I'm golden, loser. It was awesome. And you laugh because it's funny. It's It's comical when you talk about comparing yourself to other people in the gym or comparing yourself to other people when you're doing exercise. But how many of you know it's not so funny when you talk about comparing yourself to other people in life? And ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, what I'm afraid today's message mandates is that you introspectively ask the critical question, who are you racing? Who are you racing? I'm just wondering, who in your life have you set your eye on and you are running your race according to their pace instead of doing the thing that God has called you to do, instead of chasing after the purpose and the assignment and the destiny that God has placed on your life? I just came to warn you today that the comparison game is a dangerous game to play. I don't know whether you notice or not when you're running on a treadmill, which is another reason why I hate running. Have you noticed on a treadmill, you're doing a lot of movement, a lot of breathing, a lot of sweat, but you ain't going anywhere. You are in the exact same position the entire time. What a beautiful metaphor for comparing yourself to other people. Because whenever you compare yourself to somebody else, all you end up doing is exerting a lot of psychological, emotional, and spiritual energy trying to keep up and compete with somebody you were never called or created to be. And at the end of all of it, you realize, I'm in the exact same position I was when I first got started. Ooh, I'm preaching better than y'all are talking in here today. As a matter of fact, I'm just exercising something a great mentor in my life told me that I'll never forget. He said, Robert, whenever you preach, just preach from your weakness because you'll never lack for material to preach. I'm preaching from my weakness today because I have found in my own life, as I'm running the race God has set before me, I have an inner proclivity and tendency to look at the people in the lanes beside me. Hear me, church. I am convinced that comparison is the number one destroyer of destiny. I am convinced that the enemy's number one weapon of mass distraction and mass destruction is to get you to compare yourself to somebody else. It's his number one weapon, because after all, that's what got him kicked out of heaven. Satan, Lucifer, you know he used to be on the praise and worship team of heaven. It started with comparison. He was created to be a conduit, to be an expression of God's glory, but he starts comparing himself to God and said, I will exalt my throne above the Most High, and that's what got him fired and dismissed, and now his job is to kill, steal, and destroy from you and I. And that's exactly what comparison will do. It will kill your joy. It will steal your peace. It will suffocate your sanity. Comparison is the thief of joy. Comparison is like cancer to contentment. You know, I love the Apostle Paul, the artist formerly known as Saul. It's funny to me, if for nobody else. He wrote a majority of your New Testament. And when he starts bringing order and structure to the church at Corinth, he warns them about the danger of comparison. Look at what it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12. Paul says, for we dare not class ourselves or compare ourselves with those who commend themselves, but they, measuring themselves by themselves and comparing themselves among themselves, are not wise. Paul says, you are stupid. You are foolish. You are cuckoo if you are playing the comparison game. Do you know why comparison is not wise? Hear me. Because comparison will consistently cloud the clarity of God's call on your life. Ooh, that was so nice. I'm going to say it twice. Comparison will consistently cloud the clarity of God's call on your life. Meaning, if you ever want to be confused about what God has called you to do, then just start comparing yourself to what other people have been called to do. Come on, first of all, let's just establish today that there has been a call that has been placed on your life. Oh, come on, somebody. I hope you know that at City First Church today, that there is a call on your life, a divine call, that Jesus did not come to the earth, get on a cross, get up from the grave, just so we could have cute church services and you could sit on your blessed assurance and sing songs off a screen like it's Christian karaoke. But there's actually a purpose for your life. There is a call on your life. There is a destiny on your life. There is a mandate for your life. There's an assignment on your life. Come on, you may as well check your pulse. If you got a pulse, that pulse is proof positive that God ain't through with you yet, because there's a call on your life. Come on, that's why you still here in 2017. The enemy tried to kill you last year, but you still standing because God has something for you to accomplish in this time and this space and this place. Come on, all the called people, would you give God some praise up in here? I feel like preaching now. A call. There is a call on your life. There is a purpose on your life. Somebody just say, I'm called. There's a call. You do know there's a difference between a career and a calling. Ooh, See, a career is what you get paid to do. A calling is the thing you were made to do. It's the thing that when you do it, you say, "Who? I was born to do this right here." There is a call on your life. Not only that, God has given you everything you need to accomplish your call. Ooh, that's preaching stuff right there. To think that everything I need to do what God has called me to do, it's already in me. Everything you need to do what God has called you to do, guess what? It is already in you. You don't have to look outside of yourself. You don't have to be jealous of anybody. You don't have to hate on anybody. He has already given you everything you need to accomplish your call. That means if you were supposed to be taller, guess what? He would have made you taller. If you were supposed to be faster, he would have made you faster. If you were supposed to sing, he would have given you a voice. If you were supposed to dance, he would have given you some more rhythm. Come on, somebody. If you were supposed to be America's Next Top Model, he would have made you cuter. Hello. If you were supposed to be black, he would have made you black. If you were supposed to be white, he would have made you white. If you were supposed to be Latino, Buenos Dias, he would have made you Latino. You got everything you need on the inside of you. Stop complaining to the master about the pieces you didn't get and just start praising him that you're a masterpiece. Oh, come on, somebody. You are a masterpiece. You have been carefully created and meticulously made by a God that loves you. Come on, can we just take a praise break and give God some praise and thank him for making you the way he made you? Oh, come on, that's the best praise you got. I said praise him and thank him for making you the way he made you. God, thank you for this skin. Thank you for these teeth. Thank you for this hair. I am wonderfully and fearfully made. Ooh. You are a masterpiece created by the greatest artist who is God. I feel like preaching, but let me calm down just for a second and interrupt this regular scheduled sermon so that you can engage in a verbal exercise. Would you just say this? Say, I am a masterpiece. Oh, say it like you believe it. Say, I am a masterpiece. Say it like you got faith and power. Say, I am a masterpiece. I'm telling you, if that really got in your heart today, it would change the way you walk into a room. It would change the way you hold up your head. It would change the way you feel about yourself to know that you are a masterpiece created by the greatest artist who is God. As a matter of fact, if you got radical faith, when you go to work or school or wherever you're going tomorrow, I dare you to take some velvet rope and just put it around you. And when people say, "Why you got that velvet rope?" Say, "Oh, you didn't know? I'm a masterpiece. There is a God that created me. Picasso can't touch him. Rembrandt and Leonardo da Vinci have nothing on the God that formed me. I am a masterpiece." Ooh, are y'all recording this? I'm gonna watch it later. It is blessing me. A masterpiece created by the greatest artist who is God. Be happy to be who God created you to be. Hear me, when I say you're a masterpiece, that is not preacher hype. That is not feel-good phraseology. That is not self-help talk. That is the Word of God. Word of God. You don't believe me? Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10 says, "For we are God's." Ooh, he created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. That God is a strategic God, and he has already marked out a path and a lane for all of us to run in. And all you got to do, watch this, all you got to do is stay in your lane and keep your eyes on Jesus. All you gotta do is stay in your lane and keep your eyes on Jesus. I just made faith and Christianity so simple right there. Stay in your lane and keep your eyes on Jesus. That is my entire message for today. The rest is just fluff. I came all the way from Dallas, Texas to Rockford, Illinois to tell you two things. Stay in your lane and keep your eyes on Jesus. That's all I got. That's all I got. Literally all I got. Matter of fact, I'm done. God bless you. It's been so good being with you today. It sounds so simple and it sounds so elementary, but I'm finding that is the most difficult thing for people to do, just to stay in their lane and keep their eyes on Jesus. That is difficult for people to do. Come on, let's just think practically today. How many of you have ever been stuck in traffic? Anybody ever been stuck in traffic? And isn't it funny and a phenomenon, whenever you are stuck in traffic, you always, always feel like the lanes beside you are the ones that are going faster. And what do you do? What do you do? You almost wreck your car trying to get in somebody else's lane, and you would have been better off just staying in your lane. God told me to tell you, don't wreck your life trying to get in somebody else's lane. Just stay in your lane and keep your eyes on Jesus. Ooh, your lane. Your lane. Huh, your lane. Huh, your lane. Your lane. What an incredible concept. What a brilliant notion to think that God, in his goodness, in his sovereignty, in his benevolence, would take the time to give me a lane. You do know that a lane is comprised of two lines, right? Two lines make a lane. So one line here, and one line here. Sound effects always make preaching better, okay? So one line here, and one line here. Two lines make a lane. And you have to stay within the parameters of the two lines. But two lines make a lane. Interestingly enough, every single one of us, we have two destinies. There is a duality to your destiny. One destiny is universal. There's a universal destiny for every believer, and that destiny is this: to become more and more like Jesus every single day. That is the universal destiny of every believer, to become more and more like him. Come on, if we could just think like Jesus, love like Jesus, show grace like Jesus, forgive like Jesus, that is the universal destiny of every believer. So if you're sitting in this room today going, duh, what am I supposed to do in my life? I just told you, become more and more like Jesus every single day. But you do have another destiny, and it is not universal, it is unique. And that is, you're to become unlike anybody God has ever created. Because when God made you, he broke the mold. Everybody else is already taken. You may as well just be you. Do you, boo-boo, just do you. So every morning you wake up, that's how you run your race. Every morning I wake up, I'm trying to be more and more like Jesus and unlike anybody God has ever created. More and more like Jesus and unlike anybody God has ever created. And when you run like that with your eyes on him, he gives you the strength and the velocity and the fortitude to finish your race. Come on, is this helping anybody in here today? This is why, once you put your faith in Jesus, you can never say you're just anything. Like, that vernacular has to go out the window. You can't make statements like, oh, well, I'm just a school teacher. No, you're not just a school teacher. You're actually God's representative in the classroom, so the classroom can see, what does Jesus look like when Jesus teaches a class? That is your lane. You can't say, well, I'm just a nurse. No, you're not just a nurse. You are God's representative in the medical field, so the medical field can see, what does Jesus look like when Jesus gives a flu shot? That is your lane. You can't say, I'm just a lawyer. No, you are not just a lawyer. You are God's representative in the law field, so the law field can see, what does Jesus look like when Jesus takes your case? Wherever you are, that's your lane. I'll make sure I hit everybody. Somebody say, bro, you're not talking to me. I'm just a barista at Starbucks. Bro, you are not just a barista at Starbucks. You are God's representative at Starbucks, so the coffee world can see, what does Jesus look like when Jesus serves a triple grande mocha frappuccino with extra whipped cream and caramel? That is your lane. Wherever you are. See, I'm still not done. Somebody saying, Robert, you ain't talking to me because I'm just a hairstylist. Girl, you are not just a hairstylist. You are God's representative in that hair salon, so the hair salon can see, what does Jesus look like when he puts weave or extensions in somebody's hair? Wherever you are, that's your lane. And the challenge of life is to stay in your lane with your eyes on him, because the day, hear me, City First, the day you start running your race like this, let me just prophesy to you, there is a crash in your future. Selah. No wonder Saul had such a huge crash, because comparison caused him to shift all of his focus, all of his attention onto David. Make no doubt about it, there was a season in Saul's life where he was in his lane and he was running his race. I don't get it twisted. Saul was the first king of Israel. He was anointed and appointed by God to be king. And I love when the Bible starts talking about Saul, because the Bible uses very picturesque language. It says that Saul looked like a king. It says that he stood a head and shoulders above any other person. In fact, the Bible says he was good looking. Come on, somebody. When the Bible says you're good looking, can't nobody tell you ugly. Nobody. You're just telling them, read the word. You already know. This selfie is for you. So... He looked like a king, and he talked like a king, and he had king swag, and God just blessed him. He just blessed him to be king. But I found out, even in my own life, you got to be real careful with the blessing of God. Because if the brightness of the blessing ever blinds you to the blesser, it is no longer a blessing, it has become a curse. And the brightness of the blessing blinded Saul to the blesser, so much so, he was more concerned with being the king than he was with worshiping the King of Kings. He was more concerned with keeping his position than he was with chasing after God's presence, so God had to remove the kingship away from him. But there was another young boy out on the outskirts of Jerusalem who all he cared about was being in the presence of God. He didn't care about a title, he didn't care about recognition, he didn't care about likes on Facebook or retweets. All he cared about was being in the presence of God. even after his family alienated him and ostracized him and said, man, just go watch the stanky sheep. He is out there with the stanky sheep smiling and singing love songs to God with his harp until one day his dad sends him a text message and says, hey, can you go to the battlefield and bring your brothers a ham and cheese sandwich? And when he gets to the battlefield with the ham and cheese sandwich, he sees a giant who is big enough to eat hay and dumb enough to enjoy it. And he says, wait a minute, who is this uncircumcised Philistine? Well, I love David. He's gangster because that's Christian cussing right there, okay? That is classic Christian cussing. He said, who is this uncircumcised Philistine? He said, no, I ain't going to be quiet. Y'all going to let him talk about my God in front of everybody? No, not me. Where is my slingshot at? I'm going for that giant right now. I'm going to tell that giant, catch me outside. How about that? Catch me outside. I'm sorry, that was so selfish. That moment was for me, not for you. Because it was so funny to watch some of your faces go, I ain't never read that version before in my life. Let me help you this Sunday morning. Let me help you. That is the NIV, okay? Negro International Version. That's a different translation. He said, he is not going to talk about my God in front of me. Is there not a cause? He said, somebody let me know, what do you get for knocking this giant out? Because I'm about to knock him out. They said, Dave, you want to know what you're going to get for knocking him out? You're going to get the king's daughter in marriage, and you will never have to pay taxes again in your life. David said, what? Somebody hold my harp. He said, you come at me with sword and spear, but I come at you in the name of the Lord, the God of these armies whom you have defiled. This day I will cut off your head and feed your flesh to the wild beast of the field and the birds of the air. And today the world will know there is a God in Israel. Ooh, I love it. I love it. I love it. Come on, you know the story. He releases that rock from his slingshot, hits Goliath in the forehead. Goliath comes crashing to the ground. In church, as soon as Goliath hit the ground, David rose up. It was a destiny moment. You do know that all moments in your life are not created equal, but there are some destiny moments where everything shifts, where everything changes. As a matter of fact, I prayed this morning that this would be a destiny moment for somebody where the scales come off of your eyes and God shifts the trajectory of your life. This was a destiny moment for David. In a moment, in an instant, he was catapulted from obscurity into notoriety. In a moment, everybody knew David's name. They're going, David, David, he's our man. If he can't do it, nobody can. He is trending on the internet now. Everybody's going crazy about David. Kids are rewatching the fight on YouTube, talking about, Mama, I gotta get those David sneakers. They come out next week. You know they're gonna be sold out. This is a big moment for David. He has finally arrived. He's on the cover of every Wheaties box. He's doing interviews on TBN, CNN, ABC, NBC, HIJK, LMNOP. The whole alphabet wants to talk to David now. He has finally arrived. He can't go anywhere without paparazzi and TMZ showing up. Everybody wants a selfie with David now. Come on, you understand, when he defeated Goliath, he became a rock star. Literally, rock star church jokes. I'm just trying to keep you engaged. This is a big moment for David. He's finally arrived. He's defeated the giant. He cut off his head. The wicked witch is dead. The game is over. The buzzard is sounded and the fat lady is finally sung. Well, the problem is Saul didn't like what the fat lady was singing. Well, the fat lady, just a group of ladies. And here's what they sang. Saul has killed his thousands. David, his tens of thousands. And when Saul heard that, when it got into his spirit, he went from running his race like this to fixing his eyes onto David. Therefore, Saul is a case study of the downward spiral of what comparison will always do to your life, because comparison is always the beginning of the end. Okay. All of that was my introduction. Y'all laughing, but I'm being for real. Because I want to show you how Saul's speech teaches us how comparison will always start in your life. Notice quickly what Saul said after the ladies sing their song. He goes, huh, y'all gonna credit David with tens of thousands, but me with only thousands? Hold up. Y'all are gonna credit David, little old David, with his nappy head, with tens of thousands, but me with only thousands? You hear it? Hear how comparison starts? Comparison always starts with, but me. He, but me. He, but me. See, Saul can't separate David's life from his life, nor can he separate David's success from his success. He immediately connects what's going on with David to him. He, but me. Have you ever met a but me person? These are the people that see everything in life through the lens of but me. I call them but me people because no matter what's going on with somebody else, they will find a way to connect it back to them because they're always thinking about themselves. I call these people but me people. Come on, you English majors are acutely aware of the fact that but is a conjunction. Conjunction, junction. Somebody watch Schoolhouse Rock. What's your function? Hooking up phrases and clauses and making them sound right. That's what some people do in life. They connect everything in life back to, oh, that's good for you. What about me? Did you think about me? Did you consider me? What about me? What about me? What, did you talk about me? Did they talk about me? Or are you talking about me? But okay, you need a visual. Let me show you. I'm talking about the people that see everything in life through the lens of but me. Now, if I trip over something and fall on stage today, off the stage, please don't laugh, because I literally cannot see anything right now. I am completely blinded by but me. And can I tell you, church, nothing will blind you to running your race. Nothing will stop you from doing what God has called you to do like a but me attitude. Because how many know the focus of your life is not supposed to be on you? You're supposed to fix your eyes on Jesus so you can do the thing that he's called you to do. Oh, come on, somebody. If you'll get your eyes off of you, you can do what he's called you to do. Oh, but me people are the worst because no matter what's going on with somebody else, they lose the joy out of life. They lose their peace because they're always connecting stuff back to them. These are the worst people to call and tell a praise report to. Huh. Don't tell a but me person about something that's awesome in your life because they can't celebrate what's going on with you without connecting it back to them. You call a but me person up, you be like, ooh, God is good. Yes, he is. Jehovah Jireh, my provider. I finally got a raise on my job. Isn't that great? They'll go, ha, great for you, but me. Oh, God, how he gonna get a raise on his job and I ain't got a raise on my job yet? I've been coming to church longer than him. I've been giving in every offering, paying my tithe. Lord, you know my money is funny and my change is strange. How you gonna bless him before me? Oh, but me. Ooh, but me is a horrible way to live because it robs you of your joy and your peace because the focus of your life is on you instead of on him. Saul has got on the but me glasses. Somebody comes to play softly behind me because soft music playing behind a preacher makes him sound more spiritual. And and you cognitively conclude that I'm landing the plane. So how do you know if you got on the but me glasses? I think there's some signs. I think there's some Blues Clues that'll let you know if you got on the but me glasses. Number one, if you can't celebrate the successes of other people, you got on the but me glasses. If you are stingy with your compliments and you think to compliment or commend somebody else somehow takes something from you, you got on the but me glasses. If there is anybody in your life that secretly you would find joy or happiness in their failure, that's the person you're racing and you got on the but me glasses. Ooh, it's quiet in here today. And can we be honest, church? Isn't it so easy to put on the but me glasses? Isn't it so easy? Come on, I'm preaching this to you because I preached it to me. It is so easy in our culture to put on the but me glasses and say, woe is me, especially in our culture today, this culture of social media. Some of you get that tomorrow. Because you got so many devices where you can see what everybody has. Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, Snapchat, Facebook Live, Instagram Live. We are constantly inundated with everybody else's life. And isn't it funny how our awareness accelerates our discontentment? Can you imagine how happy you would be if you just didn't know? But you got notifications on your smart device that's making you stupid. And you can see everybody else's life, and if you're not careful, it'll make you hate yours. We are always putting on the but me glasses. Come on, you know. You know you were so happy. You were so happy. You were thrilled about your vacation, right? To Roscoe. Weren't you? You're like, ooh, it's gonna be a good vacation. Kids, get in the car. We're going to Roscoe. It's gonna be great. Roscoe, Illinois. You were so happy until you got on Facebook and saw one of your good friends was going to the Bahamas for their vacation. You're like, but me, Roscoe, no. I don't wanna be in Roscoe. I wanna be on the beach in the Bahamas. Oh, I hate my life. You were so happy when God blessed you with your Ford Focus, weren't you? Like, whoa, God, thank you for my Ford Focus. I am focused on my Ford Focus. I don't have to ask anybody for a ride. Ooh, hallelujah. Till you got on Instagram and saw one of your coworkers got a brand new Ferrari for their gift. Come on. And they don't even go to church. You're like, God, why have you forsaken me? So easy to put them on. And hear me, I'm not hating on Instagram or Facebook or Twitter or any of those other avenues of social media. I'm not saying it's sin. I think it's awesome. I'll be on it after the service. But sometimes I wonder, hear me, sometimes I wonder if the screens on our phones and our computers and our iPads have now become mirrors by which we constantly check for a reflection to see if we measure up to somebody else. Like a scene stolen from Snow White, we all silently echo the words of the Wicked Witch, who, by the way, checked the mirror every day just to see mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the fairest of them all. Only today it's mirror, mirror on Facebook, tell me how my life should look. Mirror, mirror on Instagram, tell me who I really am. And we keep checking every minute, every second, all day, every day. Eating lunch. In church. Preach, Robert. You know, this is a good sermon right here. Just wonder what our lives would look like if we reflected on the Word of God. Which, by the way, the book of James calls a mirror. Maybe then we could get in our lane and run the race he set before us. Church, I know we've had fun. I love to have fun in church and laugh. But I pray that the comedy did not mitigate the severity of the message. Because hear me, comparison is so lethal, it will creep into every area of your life. Every area. It'll affect your kids. Some of you think you're pushing your kids to do better in school and you want them to study hard because you want them to do good and go to university and get a great job, and you do. But there's also some comparison in there too. Because you keep getting calls from your in-laws and your coworkers who keep telling you how wonderful their children are. Oh yes, my son, yes, he's looking at Harvard or Princeton. Yeah, gonna get more degrees than a thermometer. He's very, 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 very smart. And there's your kid who can't read Dr. Seuss. And you're like, why can't you do better? Tell me, affect your finances? Thousands upon thousands of dollars in credit card debt? Spending money you don't have on things you don't need to impress people you don't even like? Just to show them anything you can do, charge it. I can do it better. Affect your relationships. Some of you have put such a weight on your spouse, trying to get them to be somebody they were never called or created to be. I'm telling you, it is time for the body of Christ to get off of their mark, to get on yours with your eyes on Jesus so you can run the race he set before you. Come on, somebody. Is there anybody that's ready to get on your mark and off of theirs? I'm done. This is my for real close. You know, every preacher has at least seven closes. This is the for real one. And I've just never been one of those preachers that can preach out stuff that God hadn't preached in. So I thought I'd kind of share with you how this whole message got started. In the not too distant past, I had this incredible opportunity to preach at this conference in Sydney, Australia. And at the time, it was my assignment to just preach to the youth and the young adults of this conference. It was like some 6,000 or 7,000 young people that were gathering for this conference in Australia. I remember being so excited. I was like, "Ooh, I'm going to Australia. It's gonna be a great week. I'm gonna preach Jesus, see some kangaroos. It's gonna be awesome." And in conjunction with the young people having their conference, there was also the main stage part of the conference. And for main stage part of the conference, some 30,000 people gather in an arena in Sydney, Australia for main stage. And the people they have preaching main stage are people who are really struggling to get their ministries off of the ground. People like Bishop T.D. Jakes, Joe Osteen, Rick Warren, and Joyce Meyer. So I said, it's gonna be awesome. I'm gonna preach to the youth and young adults, and I get to sit in and listen to these great men and women of God preach. And so I'm sitting in that arena. My wife was there with me. My wife and I knew something that the other 30,000 people didn't know yet. And that was just before we'd arrived to Sydney to just preach to the youth and young adults, I'd actually received an invitation to preach main stage at that conference the next year. So I'm sitting in that arena and I'm looking around, I'm kind of taking everything in, and all of a sudden they show the promotional video for the upcoming conference. And again, it's all these big names, magnanimous names, huge huge. Abraham Lincoln was one of the speakers they were going to have at the conference. And then my name comes up on the screen. It was so funny because the pastor, the leader of the conference, he almost had to clarify. He goes, there's one name you probably didn't recognize on the list. He said, it's Robert Madu. He said, it'll be one of the youngest speakers we've ever had to preach main stage. Then he pauses, true story, and goes, and you know what? I think I might let you get a preview of his preaching on this stage in this arena this week. Now, that would have been cool. That wouldn't have been cool if I wasn't finding out in that moment with the other 30,000 people in the arena. Immediately, my heart went into my foot. I start sweating. I see the pastor after the conference. He goes, did you hear my announcement? I go, yes, I did. He goes, true story. He goes, I'm thinking tomorrow after Bishop Jakes preaches that you could get up and preach for like 10 minutes as a preview for next year. He goes, what do you think about that? I went, yeah, that would be great. Went to the hotel room that night. True story, fell on the ground in the fetal position, tears coming down my face. I can't do this. Why would he tell me this now? He could have told me this 30 years ago. What's wrong with him? You ever had just one of those moments where your voice goes into Mickey Mouse tone because you're so overwhelmed and intimidated by an opportunity? I love my wife. She's the best. She is my CEO, my chief encouragement officer. And she said, babe, it's okay. You can do it. You can do it. I said, No, I can't. Called my dad up for some support, called him up. You know, my dad is from Nigeria. He came from Africa to America, like Eddie Murphy in the movie. And he met my mom, who is American. My mom's American. So you know when your dad's African and your mother's American, that makes you African-American. Y'all the smart class. I'm African-American. And called my African dad up for some support. I'll never forget what he said. He said, son, you can do this. Before the foundation of the earth, God knew you would be there. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. You can do this, boy. You can do it. I said, No, I can't. So nervous, so intimidated. Before I got on stage in that arena, I had a conversation that I often have with myself. I paused for a moment. I said, wait a minute. Who opened this door? Who opened this door? God did. Who did they ask to speak? Me. I can only be me. So I got up there for 10 minutes. I was me. But when I got off the stage and I was studying this text, I felt like the Holy Spirit impressed upon me a critical question. The Holy Spirit said, Robert, would you like to know the real reason why you fell on the ground in the fetal position with tears coming down your face? Thought to myself, real reason? No. I know the real reason. There were 30,000 people in the arena. Holy Spirit said, no, that's not the real reason. In fact, the real reason that you felt that weight of intimidation is because when you were listening to all those other names speak and preach, you weren't listening to the Word of God. You are actually comparing how they run their race to the way I've called you to run your race. And that's why you felt that weight of intimidation. So let that be the last time that tears come down your face because you're playing the comparison game. And why don't you just rest in the fact that I have given you a grace to run your race. There is a grace to run your race. Somebody needs to hear that this morning. I said, there is a grace to run your race. There is a grace to run your race. And I got an announcement. I'm glad to make a city first. I hope it doesn't stop me from coming back. But can I tell y'all, I'm a horrible T.D. Jakes. I am the worst Joel Osteen you have ever seen in your life. I'm not a good Billy Graham. I'm a terrible Rick Warren. I'm not a good Pastor Jeremy. Y'all know I'm not a good Joyce Meyer. But there's one thing I know beyond a shadow of a doubt. I am the best Robert Madu you have ever seen in your life. Come on, somebody. I gotta be me, and you gotta be you. This is your moment and your season to get in your lane. Get your eyes off of other people and fix your eyes on Jesus. Come on, somebody, so you can run your race. Somebody give our God some praise in this place today if you're ready to get on your mark. Hallelujah. Get in your lane. Fix your eyes on Him so you can run the race God has set before you. I'm going to ask in this moment, every head be bowed, every eye be closed. Stand to your feet if you can. Spirit of the living God, thank you for your word today. God, I pray today that a spirit of freedom would break out in this place from the front to the back. God, that weight of comparison would be lifted off of us. Lord, I'm praying for that person. They've been struggling with this for years. Maybe today I just articulated why they can't keep their joy, why they can't keep their peace. God, it's because their eyes have been on the wrong thing. Jesus, help us today to fix our eyes on you. And I know when we do that, you're going to give us the strength and the grace to run our race. With every head bowed in this place today, if you're in here today and you'd be so honest to say, you know what, Robert, this is for me. I've been playing the comparison game and I just need to fix my eyes back on Jesus. There's an old school song I love. It says, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full at his wonderful face. The things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and his grace. But it starts when you turn your eyes back towards him. If you're here today and you say, I've been playing that comparison game, I just need to fix my eyes back on Jesus so I can run my race. If that's you, would you just lift up your hand all over this place today? Say, that's me, that's me, that's me. Yeah, thank you, Jesus. Hands going up all over this place. Just lift it up, put it right back down. Thank you, Jesus. Head still bowed, I'll still close. If you're in here today and you've never taken that first step, which is to surrender your life to him, some of you just need to get in the race in the first place. Say, God, from this moment forward, my life is yours. If you're in here today and you've not made Jesus the Lord of your life, I want to pray with you. I don't care what you've been through. I don't care where you come from. Don't let the enemy lie and make you think it's too late, that you messed up too bad. No, you have a purpose and a call that is on your life. Heads are still bowed, eyes are still closed. If you've never surrendered your life to Jesus, you say, Robert, include me in that closing prayer. Would you just lift up your hand right where you are? I want to pray for you. Yeah, yeah. See those hands. Thank you, Jesus. Anybody else? Just lift it up, put it right back down. Can we pray this prayer just as one big family? We're all going to say it, but especially those of you who responded, I'm going to give you the words, but you say it from your heart. Would you say this? Say, dear Jesus, thank you so much for dying on a cross, getting up from the grave for me. Lord, I know you lived the life that I was supposed to live. You died the death that I was supposed to die. You took my place. So my response is to surrender all of me for all of you. Jesus, forgive me of my sin. Forgive me for fixing my eyes on the wrong things. But Jesus, today, in all of my life, my eyes are fixed on you. And I trust you'll give me the strength and the grace to run my race. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, amen. Come on, if you meant what you prayed, would you give Jesus some praise today? Oh, come on, City First, you can do better than that. Can we give Jesus some praise today? Woo! Come on, were you blessed by the word of God today? Just before Pastor Jeremy comes, I want to do one thing. It's going to be awkward. It's going to be a little bit weird, but it's going to help you because I believe something happened, changed today. Would you look at the person next to you? Just get in their face, get in their personal space. Look at the person next to you. Look at them, and say, neighbor, allow me to reintroduce myself. Neighbor, I want to let you know I am the best me that you will ever see. That felt too good. Come on, find another neighbor. Come on, look at the other neighbor. Say, other neighbor, I'm telling you, I am the best me that you will ever see. Come on, give God one more hand clap of praise. God bless you, City First.